Thanks. So yeah, we'll try to get through this. So like Max said, my name is Sarah. I work for Practical Farmers of Iowa. How many folks know who Practical Farmers is? Oh, you all should know. We take members in Minnesota. You don't just have to be an Iowan to join PFI. So in the last 6 years-ish, we've really done a lot more research on cover crops than we'd ever done in the past. So today I wanted to talk about, you know, who is PFI and what are we up to, and then why cover crops, and then how you can get cover crops done in Minnesota in corn and bean land. How many folks are using cover crops right now? How many folks grow corn and soybeans? Okay, there's so much opportunity. Great. So our membership is growing. We've been around since 1985, started by farmers. We host a lot of field days, and we have a lot of field days even up into the northern tier of Iowa, so I'd really encourage folks to come. And those field days are farmers talking to farmers about how to improve whatever on your farm. So if the topic is cover crops, how to get cover crops done in corn and soybean rotation. This is a breakdown of our members. So, you know, the membership is normal, I'd say, or traditional row crop, hay, soybeans, things like that in Iowa. You know, it's folks like yourselves are members of PFI. And beyond these events, we also have these great listservs. So if you become a member, let's say, you know, you put in a cover crop and it's spring and it's cold and you sprayed glyphosate on it and it's just not dying and you're nervous and you want to ask some other farmer experts, you can send an email to our cover crop list. And within 10 to 15 minutes, five people at least will respond and say, be patient, or better go spray it again, or whatever the recommendation is. So we really have a lot of traffic on this cover crops list, which has been crucial for farmers just learning more about how we do cover crops in Iowa. So I just want to remind us all of where we're at with corn and beans right now, right? So this is 1938 to 2002. These are three different townships in Iowa. And where we see multiple colors, we see multiple crops on the landscape. So how many folks used to grow oats, alfalfa, small grains? Okay. And now most of us said we grow corn and soybeans. So we've had this major shift in the crops we're growing on the landscape, and that's maybe causing some of our water quality problems. And there's data that backs that up. So what we see farmers trying to do now is to work back in those cool season plants. So small grains, what time of the year do small grains grow? Cold, right? Cold soil temperatures, April-ish. When does corn grow? When do you plant corn? What soil temperature do you plant corn at? Above 50. So corn is a warm season plant, right? So corn and soybeans are two warm season plants. They're grown from sometime May-ish until sometime September-ish. But small grains and hay are cool season plants. So those things grow in the winter time. Those things grow in that cool season time period. And so when our rotation used to be more diverse, we were covering the soil a longer time of the year. Okay? So now we might not all run out and want to start growing oats again, unless we bring some markets back or start doing some creative uses with them. But we see farmers wanting to use cover crops on corn and beans to work those cool season grasses and legumes back into corn and bean ground. Does that make sense? So to cover up that winter window. So this is just from Wright County. Yellow parts are corn and green parts are soybeans. And we've seen an increase in cover crops in this county. And this is, you know, just a couple tiers south of here into Iowa. And there's around 10,000 acres in this county right now that are cover crops. So these farmers who would have typical systems like yours are trying to work back in a cereal rye, which would be that cool season grass, to cover up that winter window. So, you know, and just a reminder, as the 1950s approached, we really dramatically decreased our acreage of small grains and alfalfa, the cool season plants in our rotation, and soybeans really took off. We've grown about the same amount of corn in this area since the 1930s, but soybeans displaced a lot of our cool season plants. So we had a warm season plant, we added another warm season in soybeans, and we got rid of the cool seasons. So now we see farmers saying, we got to get the cool seasons back into our rotation, and cover crops is one way to do that. So why should I plant cover crops? What are some reasons you've heard on why you should be using cover crops? Reduce soil erosion. You can't answer.
Build biodiversity.
What else?
Scavenge
nutrients.
Build organic matter.
Great. This is a picture from far southeast Iowa. This farmer had drilled winter rye after harvest in the fall, and then this next spring he had a major rainfall event. And you can see the water there. He probably needs a waterway there also. This cover crop has been killed with Roundup. And you can see it's slowing the water down. The water's relatively clean. You can see in it, you can't see a lot of sediment in there. So it's doing its job. This is in April. What does the ground normally look like in April? Snow or, if we don't have snow, snow mixed with dirt, black, especially if we do a lot of tillage, right? So that just is potential for a lot of bad things to happen. So we can see here, although this picture's kind of dark, this is data from Tom Casper, who's down in Ames. So where we have no cover crop after 4.5-inch rainfall, erosion is obvious. Even with an oat cover crop, so we planted oats in the fall, it winter kills. We have just the straw there in the spring, but it's still anchoring corn and soybean residue in place. We have reduced erosion. And then where we have a winter rye cover crop, cereal rye, that overwinters, we basically don't see much erosion there. Why would reducing erosion be important to your farm? It preserves your fertility, right. So let's say this room is our farm, and here on this edge I put a waterway in, or I put a buffer or a terrace, and I grow corn and soybeans where you're all sitting. Where does the soil go during a rainfall event? Even on flat ground, where does the soil go? Does it stay there, or does it come over to me in the waterway? Goes to the waterway. Do you grow corn and soybeans in the waterway? No, you grow corn and soybeans there, right? So you need to keep the soil in place because that's future yield protection. Soil is how you grow crops. Okay, so another thing that corn does, or that cover crops do, is reduce nitrates in our tile lines. So this is data out of Iowa State. There is data from Minnesota. I didn't stick it in here. So we see a 29% reduction in nitrogen from cover crops, 29% reduction in phosphorus, and that would be, you know, phosphorus attached to soil or dissolved phosphorus. We see soil erosion decreased, and then we see greater water infiltration. Have you all been seeing heavy rains in the spring like we've seen in Iowa? Yeah? So what happens about July, except for this year? What normally happens in July and August? There's no rain, right? It's dry. Okay, so we got all this rain in April, and then we really need it in July, right? When seed is filling and we need that moisture. So if we can harvest that rain by getting it into the soil profile, getting it down into the profile for roots to use in July, we're going to be better off, right? We're going to have soybeans that are going to grow longer, and we're going to have corn that's going to fill out better. So we need better water infiltration. When rain hits the soil that's bare, it explodes the soil, it creates a crust, and you get a lot of overland flow. Cover crops get in the way of that. See this green carpet right here? That physically is going to take that raindrop velocity, that speed, and disperse it and allow the water to get down into the soil profile. Okay? So that's really why also we want to have cover crops. Okay, so now I'm going to go through a farmer testimonial, some on-farm research. This guy farms in Wright County, so there's his county. He grew corn and soybeans up until 2011. The nitrate levels are here on the left-hand side. You can see nitrates, milligrams per liter. This dotted line is the drinking water standard, which is 10 milligrams per liter. His tile lines are these red dots right here, and then the streams and creeks around his farm are the green circles and triangles. And so traditionally we would see a higher concentration of nitrate coming out of your tile lines than in streams and creeks because it's diluted as it goes further down. So in 2011, this was his baseline data. Then he decided to plant cover crops. You can see this is an aerial seeded cover crop. It was aerial seeded on September 5th into standing corn. This is the spring when he strip-tilled into that cover crop, and he was also putting on nitrogen in the spring. So not much growth out there in the spring, but some. Oh, that's not good. It's a green cover crop there. And then this is another field that he also had flown cover crops on into. So In 2012, we see his DOTS come down dramatically. So he's almost averaging the drinking water standard in 2012 by just implementing these three practices. While the streams and creeks around his farm are higher in 2012, he's still growing corn and soybeans. All he did was add cover crops, tweak nitrogen application, and he moved strip tillage in that year to the spring, but now he sometimes does strip tillage in the fall or sometimes does it in the spring. He is on heavy prairie pothole soil, okay, with a lot of tile drainage. So now 2013 comes. Before I show you that, what do you think happened in 2013? What was the water, what happened in 2012 and 2013 that might affect nitrates? It was a dry year in 2012, so we didn't use a lot of the nitrogen that was out there. And then what happened the spring of 2013? The deluge, right? Like massive amounts of water. So we see in 2013, here's all 3 years, the streams and creeks around his farm had all that nitrogen that had been left over from 2012 in their water bodies, and his farm is still down here near the drinking water standard. So if he's already sending water down to the Des Moines Water Works that's half as much as the streams and creeks, they're not going to gripe as much, right? And there's less potential for future regulation. He still grows corn and soybeans, but he did have to tweak his system. It's not business as usual, okay? So this is why this happens. The annual grain crop season is here, and this is when we're using the most of our nutrients. And then in the fall, when we have nothing growing, that's our biggest times for nitrate leaching in the spring and the fall, and that's when nothing is growing on our landscape. So that's why we need those winter small grains, winter grasses, stuck into the system. Okay, so now you know why you should plant cover crops. What cover crops have you experimented with, those who have planted them? I don't want you to fall asleep. What have you practiced, played around with? Cereal rye, brassicas, clovers. Great. So I'm going to talk about first the system where we're overseeding into corn and soybeans, because I think that's probably the best system for this far north that we should be focusing on if there's enough moisture. So we've got the cash crop here, and then we're going to overseed into it with a cover crop. So how many folks know pilots that do cover crops, that can fly on cover crops? There's some in the room here today. I have a list of pilots in the back also. So your same pilot that sprays fungicides or insecticides can switch over to a dry box, and they can fly on cover crops for you. And you want to do that sometime August 20th-ish until sometime September 15th-ish. It'd be great if the canopy was opening up and you were flying on at that time. There's also modified highboys out there. This is one from Heggie down in Clarion. This is a site that's part of the Soil Health Partnership that was mentioned earlier with Monsanto. We're working on one of these sites with them. So Heggie went out and overseeded into corn, and then there's another plot that's into beans, and then there's another plot that's corn. And we put on oats, radish, and vetch September 18th. This is what it looked like about a month later, so you can already see some of the growth happening. So we just accumulate more growing degree days the earlier we get it planted. I'm going to show you a video. So these soybeans are a little past the time when they could have been planted. You probably could have gotten in there a couple weeks earlier because they're pretty dried down. You want to make sure there's not a lot of leaves on the ground because you want the seed underneath the leaf. You can see the seeds right there. See them? And you want about 20 seeds per square foot for a rye to have a decent stand, for just a cover crop stand, not livestock usage or anything. About 60. 60 is probably good. If rain is predicted, and you can really time it well with rain. You could drop down your seeding rate maybe 10 pounds, but you know, September's kind of iffy on rain. So this year was probably the best year to fly on cover crops because we were so wet. There was good soil moisture and there was a lot of rain predicted, so we got good stands pretty much everywhere. But normally September's kind of iffy, so I would say stick with 60 pounds. Yeah, the planes are about the same as what custom drilling would be, so anywhere from 15 to 18 an acre for the plane. And then the seed is, well, Albert Lee can tell you what they have. I'm thinking it's about 17 an acre for seed. So it costs $30 to $35 an acre. What's nice about getting it flown on is that it's out of the way. And sometimes we do hear of farmers going together and getting semi-truck loads together, so they bring the cost down. And you could go between winter rye, winter wheat, or winter triticale, whichever one's cheapest at the time. They really all act pretty similarly. So I know folks that got like winter wheat this year because winter rye was just more expensive, and that's fine. That it'll perform really, really similarly to winter rye. So this is just kind of, you know, summing up what I've said. The earlier we plant, the better off we are. So aerial seeded radish versus drilled radish after soybean harvest. So September planting date into standing soybeans versus October drilled date after harvested beans. And this is rapeseed versus drilled rapeseed. Rapeseed's a good alternative to tillage radish, to cover crop radish. It's cheaper, and we've seen it perform very similarly. So as you get started into cover crops, winter rye is probably gonna be your mainstay, but you might wanna look at the brassicas to enhance nutrient cycling. And rapeseed is a really good choice. There you can see a picture of a radish. How many people have seen the huge radishes? Yeah, oh yeah, everybody's seen these. They're larger than my child. So what size does that radish look like? Does that look like the radishes you've seen? No. You're never gonna get that large radish unless you plant it after small grain harvest. It needs to be planted early in August into an open field, prevent plant, maybe early seed corn, maybe early sweet corn. Small grains is how you get the ginormous radish. And it does a lot of benefit. But I would be careful sticking it into corn and soybeans because that's as big as it's gonna get. And it's three-ish dollars a pound. Rapeseed's a dollar a pound, and you're gonna get similar performance. Yes. Eli's gonna disagree with me. Yeah, so what's the benefit of the tuber and then just the radish in general? So brassicas, the brassica family, which is like broccoli, cauliflower, radishes, turnips, that family builds fungi populations. So fungi really like the chemicals that are in these plants, and fungi make phosphorus plant available. So brassicas do great things for the soil. The special thing about the radish is that tuber helps with getting rid of compaction. And so farmers really want to use the radish to deal with compaction issues without doing tillage. But you're not going to get the ginormous tuber unless you plant it at the right time and you give it enough time to grow. So you're still going to get a little bit of a taproot. I mean, you can still see a taproot right there on that rapeseed. Rapeseed might overwinter if there's enough snow cover. Radish definitely won't overwinter. So then you'd have the rapeseed in the spring to grow a little bit more. And then it's going to break down and it's going to start releasing the nitrogen and phosphorus that it would have taken up. So brassica family in general, I think, is good to start adding in to the grass group as you get started with cover crops. And, you know, just stick radish in at the right place. Okay, is there a handout on your table that has three pictures on the back of the three groups of cover crops? So some might need to share. Yes, question.
I've been hearing there's some research that the radishes aren't working as well as they thought about scavenging the nutrients because when they die over the winter, it's still leaving some opportunity for the nutrients to
leach
away, mm-hmm. away in the spring. And so they're really only pushing more towards putting them in mixes. Is that what you mean?
Yes, good point. So our radishes actually may be increasing nitrate loss. It can, yeah. So if radish was planted all by itself, a heavy rate, like 8 pounds to the acre, we've seen data out of Illinois and Indiana that says before corn is planted, it'll have flushed maybe 80 to 90 pounds of nitrogen. So if there's a rain and soils are warm in the spring, it will either be nitrate or ammonium, and so it will flush very quickly. So putting a radish in a mix with a grass, which I would always suggest, is what you want, so you can slow down decomposition of that radish. So you can synchronize that nitrogen release better with when corn needs it. So you're right. Yes. No, the brassicas in general are pretty, they are a very low carbon to nitrogen ratio plant. So they're going to flush nitrogen the minute the soil's warm and it rains. So it doesn't matter if it's radish or rapeseed. It would just matter how big they are. Yeah. So like those large radishes, we had a test last year from Plainfield, so northeast Iowa. There was 241 pounds of N in the fall, just in the above ground stuff. We just cut it off at the soil surface. We didn't even pull the tuber out, which there's probably this much more tuber left because these are planted after prevent plant. And there was already 241 pounds of N in that above ground biomass. So that could have easily flushed this spring very quickly. Okay, so on that sheet, there's three groups. There's a green group, a red group, and a blue group. And I just want to make sure that you know sort of the broad groups so you know what to talk about when you want to talk about cover crops. So the green group are the grasses. Winter small grains, spring small grains like oats or wheat, annual ryegrass also could be in that category. So those are like our scavengers and our erosion protectors, and they like hunker down for the winter and really cover the soil. So I'd say you always want to have the green group in your mix. And then as you want to branch out, normally we might say legumes, which is the blue group, because we're used to growing alfalfa, we've grown vetch before, it can provide us with nitrogen. But in the short winter window that we're sticking them into, we just don't have enough heat to get them to grow. So like hairy vetch planted mid-September, and then you know maybe it overwinters and it's there the next spring, it's probably using soil nitrogen. It's probably not actually fixing nitrogen yet by the time you kill it to go to corn, unless you delayed corn planting. The vetch has to be like this tall for you to get 60 pounds of nitrogen out of it. So it's not that I don't like the blue group. They, you know, provide some benefits, but I'd say the red group, which are the brassicas, are gonna flush nitrogen faster, like what he was just talking about, and then that's gonna possibly give you yield increases to corn. So I would say green group for sure, because that's the protection, and then red group to mix in for potential nitrogen increases. But you gotta test this, right? You know, we're just now starting to do yield checks on corn following our mixes that had the red and the green group in them. I don't have that data today to present, but we do see some indication that maybe there would be yield increases following that. So that may be a way to help have the cover crop pay for itself. Okay, so cover crop species evaluation. We want to make sure that the species that we're, you know, having farmers try are actually going to perform in our climate. Most of the data from cover crops is from Pennsylvania and Ohio, which is not our climate or our rotation. So we've put out variety trials the last couple of years. These are locations in Iowa from last year's trial. We are looking for locations for Minnesota for next fall if anybody wants to participate. These are little bags of seeds that we mail and then we give a cover crop evaluation kit. And so we're testing 18 different varieties here. And on the back of your sheet are the varieties that we're testing this year. You can see the trials on the back of there. So you can just see the ones we're trying. So this is what a plot usually looks like, and this is the evaluation kit, which is a rope, very high-tech rope with marks on it. And farmers go out, we pay farmers to go out and count how many times the leaf area touches the rope so we know what the ground cover looks like. And so then that helps give us data. So this is ground cover here, percent ground cover. In the fall are the red bars, or the blue bars, and that's sometime around Thanksgiving. And the red bars are sometime around Easter. And this is from 2012-2013. So over here, over here are the grasses. And cereal rye, this first one, so you see fall growth is about 50% of the plot. Red growth in the spring before we have much growth green up. is near that. And then we have the triticales, the barley. So in the fall, the winter small grains really get started the same. But then in the spring, barley's just slower to get going. So maybe barley's something you want to try because it doesn't get growing as fast. And before corn, maybe you can handle it better. Maybe you can spray it first better than rye, which is obviously growing very quickly underneath the snow even. Then we have our legumes that we evaluated. So common vetch, hairy vetch, and winter lentil seem to do pretty good. And then this is from last year's trial. This is 2013-2014. We did brown mustard. In addition to the other varieties, we tested brown mustard. So this is what it looks like before the soybeans got harvested. And this is the brown mustard you like weeded. You know, the one with the little yellow head that you weeded as a child probably. Don't be scared of it, it's a cover crop. So this is fall growth from 2013. I'm only showing you fall growth because nothing overwintered last year except for cereal rye because it was so cold. So you can see cereal rye has, you know, anywhere from 80% growth of the plot down towards 10% depending on the location. Mustard did really well, and then cereal rye and radish did really well. Here we have spring wheat and oats together. We wanted to test those. Oats is light, and it's a little harder for pilots to fly on. So we thought spring wheat would be heavier, and it doesn't have a hull, so maybe it gets started easier than oats. So they seem to perform similarly in this test, and then we're going to have them again in this next year's test, just to see if maybe you could swap out oats for spring wheat instead. Have you guys flown on spring wheat? Which do you prefer, oats to spring wheat? Spring wheat, because it flies like rye.
Right.
Yeah.
It can tolerate the wind
too. Yeah, right. Okay, so this is one of our plots from that variety trial. We seeded this on September 8th, and this is by November 9th, and this is what a close-up looks like. So we've got rye, rape, and vetch in there. And then this is the spring sampling that happens before farmers would kill it. So this helps us just to, you know more about what works well in Iowa. And this needs to be tested in Minnesota also. What works well in Minnesota? So we see, you know, cereal rye obviously works the best, and the winter small grains in general are good. And then the brassicas and legumes like rapeseed and brown mustard seem to work better than radish. And then hairy and common vetch. Okay, so let's say, were there any questions on those things? Yeah. I don't know if there's a difference between brown and yellow. We haven't tested them differently. Sounds like a project.
Are these all capable
what?
To be grazed?
Yes. Yes, so I would say the only cover crop I would be nervous about would be sorghum Sudan grass, just because after it gets frosted, which you probably already know that. But yeah, there's some handouts back there on the hay savings from a rye cover crop. Even when it's pretty small, as long as it's grazable or hayable, you can really reduce stored feed costs. And then if you can get the brassicas in there, that's just better forage quality. There was a farmer who, he's done corn and soybeans only for a long time, and then he decided to grow rye for seed. And so he planted a really diverse mix, and it took off really well. And so now he's having a neighbor bring in cattle to graze his farm. It's not his cattle, it's someone else's. And the relative feed value was like better than what it would be for a lactating dairy animal. And that was after the frost. So the quality was good, and there was a lot out there because we just had so much rain. You know, he really scored this year. Where last year the quantity would have probably been half because we just didn't have enough moisture really. So yeah, if you have livestock, that's a no-brainer. Even corn silage, rye silage, absolutely. Or regular, you know, corn grain with rye for silage or for grazing, absolutely. If it's grazable, you know, so you got to go test it. You got to pull it and see if it snaps versus pull the root out of the ground, because otherwise you'll take the plants out. Okay, so if crop harvest is late, you might want to consider overseeding. So, you know, if you're going to do cover crops, you don't want to think about this in September. You need to get started, like, right after planting on what you're going to do. When did we plant? What's the season feeling like? Has it been cold, so we're going to be late on harvest? Has it been warm, so we're going to be early on harvest? Should I drill? Should I get the plane? Where can I get my seed? So you need to start thinking about those things. So if crop harvest is late, like I mean after September 30th to me, is what I consider the cutoff, you want to use a plane or a high boy and about first yellow leaves of soybeans or corn black layer, or a couple weeks ahead of that, I think you can go. And these are, you know, some recommendations from the variety trials that we've had. So rye triticale wheat or barley at those rates, spring wheat oats, annual rye grass too. And then the legumes are okay. And then the brassicas, you know, if there's enough moisture, I'd say you could stick the brassicas in. I would just be careful on radish. I would go more towards mustard or rapeseed. So then there's also the cover crop window after harvest. So here's our cash crops, and then here's after harvest planting. Winter rye, you can seed any time. Like you could frost seed winter rye and it will still be there in the spring. Just its growth won't be as much, so its soil erosion protection and nutrient scavenging won't be as much either. But if things are late, you could do it. So you can plant or drill following the combine. You want to get out there as soon as possible. Rye, triticale, wheat are probably the best choices at this time. Barley, it's a little late for barley after harvest, I'd say, unless harvest is really early. And then here's some of the cool season broadleaves that you could mix in, but they are expensive. So as you're getting started, I wouldn't do the whole farm in a grass and a broadleaf right away. Brassicas at this time of the year, it's probably too late to plant any of the rapeseed or radishes. It's probably just too late at this time of the year for those. So this farmer was part of a study, will cover crops hurt my corn yield? So we set up these trials, cover versus no cover. So every fall it's rye, and every spring the farmers kill it, and then they plant corn or soybeans. There's a handout of this trial in the back. So from our multiple site years, we see the red is no difference in soybean yield, the blue is increases in soybean yield, and the green is one site year had a decrease in soybean yield following rye. This is corn yield. The red is no difference in corn yield following winter rye. And the green are three site years, there was a decrease in corn yield. And I'm gonna tell you what happened. So in Jefferson in 2009, glufosinate failed to kill winter rye. So has anybody used Liberty? It's a little touchier than Roundup. So if you're gonna use that to kill rye, you wanna make sure conditions are good. So he wasn't able to kill the cover crop, which was herbicide failure, so he had a dramatic decrease in corn yield. And then in 2010 in Coon Rapids in Harlan, we can't explain why there was those differences in corn yield. It could have been plant population, planter settings, but we're not really sure. But the other years were all neutral statistically. Some data just that came out yesterday from a Midwest survey from CTIC and SARE. These are different states at the bottom. This is corn yield, and corn falling cover crop is green. Corn falling no cover crop is blue. And so if we look at Minnesota, from 26 farmers that responded, corn yield was 155 versus 149. And then Iowa was 167 versus 168. So not much difference in corn yield. And then soybean yield from the same report, for Minnesota, 41.8 bushels in soybean yield following a cover crop versus 39, no cover. So a yield increase, and that mimics our on-farm data. And then Iowa was nearly the same. So, you know, in the short term, you're probably not going to improve corn yield with just a winter cereal grain. You'd have to start working in the brassicas. But you are going to start protecting that soil for future yield protection, which is going to pay off. Okay, last thing I think I can handle. So cover crop termination. So what are ways that we could terminate a cover crop? I'm gonna let you talk for a second.
Herbicide,
what else?
Tillage.
Freezing, winter kill?
Harvesting it, rolling it.
Great. So there's lots of options. Probably the most typical is glyphosate. So winter freezing, winter kills these cover crops. Or for overwintering, you want to make sure you have a full rate of the herbicide. The plant needs to be growing, and it needs to be a warm day-ish. So You know, kill it between 10 and 12 in the morning or 10 and 1. So you get a good uptake of the herbicide. Tillage is an option. And then roller crimping, which I'm going to show a picture. So this is a dying cover crop. And then this is a roller crimping cover crop being roller crimped. So you can see in the front, it's smashing the straw down. And this would occur probably May 28th or May 25th in Minnesota. And then soybeans are planted in the back here. And so then this is their weed control all season long. So if you could delay soybean planting a couple weeks, if you have weed resistance issues, this may be a good alternative to using glyphosate in this year. This guy planted his soybeans green, so he planted into that living cover crop, and then he'll come back and burn it down. So you can see the soybeans there. And then these are just some takeaways from farmers who use glyphosate to kill a rye cover crop. So I would separate fertilizer application from the burn down. I would do the burn down first, unless you've practiced with it enough and you feel like that's okay. Make sure water pH is correct. I don't know if I'd put any atrazine with it. I'd probably just do the burn down first. And then you plant into it. What needs to happen at planting if we're going into all that residue? What do we need to do to our planter? Trash whippers? Down pressure? Coulters, pay attention. Get off the planter several times and make sure you're getting the slot closed, especially with corn. This is totally doable with corn or soybeans. That cover crop is dead. It'd be great with corn planting. You have about 50 pounds of nitrogen on at planting. Not 50 extra pounds, just of your program, move 50 pounds towards planting or right after in side dress, just to help overcome any nitrogen tie-up in the first 2 weeks of emergence. But this is doable, you just have to be mindful about planting. Yes?
So Sarah, we here at CDOS, we don't normally, we wouldn't recommend somebody to plant corn into rye. Is that big? Are we wrong? Because we're always concerned about potential allelopathic effects. Inhibition of the corn seedling into rye, this was that big, whereas soybeans, that wouldn't be concerned. You just say what your experience is.
Yeah, so we've done some studies with, is allelopathing causing corn decreases in yields? So we've washed roots, corn roots, with juices from rye, and also killed cover crop at different times near corn planting. And it's not actually an allelopathic effect. So allelopathy would show delayed germination. So that's how allelopathy affects weed seeds. It delays their germination. But when we plant corn into rye or after rye is killed, we don't see delayed germination. We see yellow corn like a month later or a month and a half later. So it seems that it's a nitrogen tie-up issue. And I would say for the first farmer doing cover crops, you are correct. Don't recommend this system. It's probably too advanced. But if for somebody who's been messing with cover crops for a number of years and they know how to plant into higher residue and they can put on nitrogen at planting like 50 pounds or side dress, those are gonna avoid any of the issues. Nitrogen's really the issue at planting with being behind rye. Now, if you mixed in the brassicas and you got a good stand of brassicas, like 60% rye and 40% brassicas in the spring, I think you could get away with not using that nitrogen because you'd have that from the cycling of the brassica. But you're not always gonna get a good stand of brassicas, like you will always get a good stand of rye. Does that make sense? Kinda. How many people can put nitrogen on or do put nitrogen on at planting? Some. How many side dress? A few. Yeah, so you could easily handle this system to get started. You know, try 50 acres and you'd be fine. Yeah. I don't think you should put rapeseed on really probably past October 1st. Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't put on radish at all. Rapeseed is probably late. It's probably even, October's probably even too late.
Yeah, I mean, there's an economic component to that, right? So as Sarah pointed out, the rapeseed's a lot cheaper, so you can afford to seed it a little bit later.
Right.
The potential loss is smaller, but the radish, you probably want to have that on by September 1st, or September 10th, very late.
Yeah. Yeah, so because rape is cheaper, maybe you could go later, but performance-wise, I think after mid-September, it's just kind of late for it to really do much good.
Could you, if you have beans as a crop and you want to put rye on behind your beans, but keep the rye as a crop, could you plant rape seed with the rye and then spray it with 240 in the spring? If you want to keep the rye for crop.
And you're going to harvest the rye for seed? Well, you definitely could plant rye after soybean harvest. I do know folks that mix a brassica with rye to increase rye yield. So that's been studied in Kansas. Usually it's with tillage radish, not with rapeseed. Yeah, I mean, I don't know why you couldn't spray 2,4-D on rye to kill the rape, if the rape overwintered, if it overwintered.
But could you go buying beans with rape and make it
benefit? Not much, I don't think. I think you need to shorten up your beans and hope that the weather shortens them up, right? Because even a shorter season bean isn't always much earlier harvested. I would just plant 2.5 bushels of rye behind beans and take the yield and put 40 pounds of nitrogen on in the spring early. And then you'll probably get 50 bushels of rye to the acre. That's probably a decent yield for these soils. And then sell it. And make more money than growing corn and beans. Yeah. There's not enough seed cleaners for everybody to do it. Yeah, so he put on hog manure after bean harvest and then planted rye. So how big is the rye right now? Short? Yeah, so the rye is definitely going to take up the hog manure, which is good. It's going to stabilize it, so you're going to have less leaching. It's probably not going to give it back as fast as you'd hope in these first couple of years. Maybe by year 5 or 6, you'll be cycling faster because more of the biology will be there to cycle that rye. Like you'll notice after you've planted rye for a number of years, we notice this, the straw in the spring, sometimes by July, is gone. But that's after a number of years of using cover crops. So if the straw is gone, then that tells me the biology has broken it down and that's flushing nitrogen for you, which is what you want. I'd say in the future, if you could fly on the rye, harvest the beans, then inject the manure into the rye, because you're just gonna capture more of the manure. And then over time, you're gonna just start stocking all that N they didn't lose, right? So then that's gonna come back to you. But it's going to take a while. It's not real fast. Can you side dress? I would do the late spring soil nitrate test and just have that tell you where you're at. And if usually rye after the late spring says about 30 to 40 pounds is needed. And so if it doesn't tell you that, then that's good. Then you might not need extra. If it does tell you that, then I would put on 30 to 40 pounds. Because the rye's probably gonna flush that nitrogen like in October or the next year. Just takes a while, because it's a high carbon to nitrogen ratio crop, especially if it's this big, right? So if you killed it smaller, it'll flush faster, but then you don't get as much benefit. See what I mean? Yeah. What are some other questions? Yeah, so his point is good. So, you know, the first couple of years, you got to be patient with this. Number one, you're learning how to do it, and your soil biology is trying to figure out how to break it down. And those, you know, soil microbes have made relationships with plants that we'll never barely understand. And they make relationships with the winter small grains differently than they do with, like, corn. So the microbes that align with the root zone of the winter small grains know it's going to go dormant for a certain period of time, but sugars still leach into the soil from that plant that's barely photosynthesizing, so that microbe stays alive all season. So the more you have a plant in the ground keeping microbes alive, the more you're going to have that cycling in the future. But those populations don't come back year one. They take years to come back. Yeah. Yeah.
One thing we're looking at doing is we've been experimenting with the legumes as far as not so much that it's building nitrogen for next year, but it's building nitrogen to help that grass crop that we're putting in.
Mm.
So that scavenges it up and releases the following year possible. Do you feel that could be a benefit looking at trying to promote that way versus saying we're trying to build so much in for next year?
Yeah. Yeah, so he was saying they're using legumes as it would affect the grass growth of the cover crop because it would flush nitrogen in the spring that the rye cover crop would take up. Yeah, I mean, if there was enough growth out there, yeah, I could see that. It just, to me, doesn't have a lot of growth, and it's expensive. But common vetch isn't as expensive, so maybe that would be. One system I didn't suggest that probably will work here and to the west would be overseeding third week of June time. So some side dress, last cultivation, third week of June time before the canopy closes in corn only. That may be a good place to use the last of the spring rains, get something started that can stay dormant under the corn canopy all season, and then be there when you harvest. And that would be a much cheaper way to get cover crops done. We haven't done enough experimenting with that June planting date, so that's why I didn't show anything. But in South Dakota, in Brookings, South Dakota, they have. So they're doing ryegrass, crimson clover, white clover, cereal rye. They're trying a whole bunch of different species third week of June. And they're overseeding, like, you know, a broadcast spreader on your last herbicide pass. That's when you'd go in, into corn. And then if it can tolerate the heat and the shade of July and August and make it, then, you know, you're ahead. And then once the crop canopy opens up, then you have a big cover crop out there. So if you were corn on corn or you had livestock, that may be a good system, is to plant sometime third week of June. And technically right now, crop insurance-wise, that's a really big gray area. So if you were going to do that, I would talk to your crop insurance agent first because the third week of June planting is gray. It's not well-defined in whether that's legal under crop insurance. And just a reminder for termination, so the blue counties can terminate cover crops 5 days after corn or soybean planting and still be able to insure your cash crop with crop insurance. And the pink counties, which is the majority of Minnesota, you have to terminate at the day of cash crop planting. And termination could be herbicide tillage or grazing event, livestock, any way that is killing the cover crop. And I would say, you know, have that discussion with your crop insurance agent. If you're going to use livestock, especially to kill it, I would have that discussion now. So Minnesota's most of the pink counties. So it's day of planting is when you would need to spray. So you have some extra time to let it grow. Agronomically, you might not want to do that, but crop insurance-wise, you're legal to do that. Does that make sense?
How does a new farm bill interact with all of this?
Well, I mean, EQIP and CSP, which are the two NRCS programs that fund a lot of cover crop acres, took big hits. They didn't have as much funding as we would have hoped. So that's where cover crop acres that are cost-shared by NRCS as you get started, which is something you should take advantage of because you can get $42 an acre to get started. The Freeborn office is just right here. And then, you know, for the first couple of years, you can have the government help pay for that learning curve of cover crops. But overall, Farm Bill, I don't know. I don't think there's much difference. Yeah.
I've heard some rumors that there's a little talk that crop insurance rates might be better in the future if you plant a cover crop.
That's what we're pushing for. So just like Wellmark and Blue Cross want you to exercise and eat vegetables to get cheaper health insurance, or you have a good driver's discount for car insurance. There's talk with crop insurance that there would be, you know, a sustainable farm option. So you would get a reduced premium and still have the same coverage if you were using a whole suite of practices that included cover crops. So it'd probably be reduced tillage, distribution of nitrogen, not putting all your nitrogen on at the same time, but distributing it, and using cover crops would help get you a reduced premium. But we're a ways from that.
We tried some of that V6
planting?
Yeah. Like,
This year it was?
Yeah.
Oh.
We had 13 inches of rain.
Too much rain.
And then we ended up trying it like the end of June. It's about a week late, but we still tried it.
Yeah.
We got spots where it came really good. We had spots where it didn't. So we're trying to figure out what the herbicide issue is. The rye didn't come at all. The rest of the clover came. The rye was really bad. We flew more rye in.
Yeah, so he's just saying he had spotty establishment at the V6 time. I think ryegrass probably will handle it better, that shade, than cereal rye will. You might have to change your herbicide program a little bit. So dual at a really high rate, really close to cover crop rye planting will ding rye, but it's the only herbicide that we've seen that will ding rye. The brassicas and the legumes are a little bit more sensitive. So you might, you know, you'd really have to think about the other herbicides. Annual ryegrass. So what is annual ryegrass? Who knows what the seed looks like? What's it look like? The guy in the back, not you, someone else respond. What's it look like?
Grass seed.
Grass seed, so it's fluffy, it's what's in your lawn, it's good for cattle, it's in pastures. So it's come over to the cover crop side because there's a lot of money in cover crops, so that's why we see annual ryegrass, I think. Supposedly it winter kills here 100% of the time. If there's enough snow cover in Iowa, it won't. And it doesn't warm up as fast in the spring. That's my biggest concern about it. So it grows at like 40 degrees, where rye and the winter small grains grow at 33, 34. So in the spring, they're ready to take an herbicide a week earlier than ryegrass would be in our climate. Now, south of 34, Highway 34, south of 74 into Illinois, maybe that's not a big deal because it's warm enough and you can get an herbicide to kill it. But a lot of farmers say ryegrass is resistant to glyphosate, the annual ryegrass, not Italian, but annual, when probably it's just a failure of the herbicide to kill it. And then you've dinged the plant, and now it's going to be harder to kill it. It has to grow out of that for 2 weeks before you can spray again. So, I don't know, I'm kind of lukewarm on ryegrass. I don't think it fits.
So is that only an issue if your annual ryegrass?
If it overwinters, right. Yeah, so if it didn't overwinter and you had enough fall growth to really be worth it erosion-wise, which I haven't really seen that. So let me just show fall growth. Hold on. We've been screening quite a few ryegrass because I wanted to see, you know, how does it perform? Okay, so it's right here, ryegrass and ryegrass compared to cereal rye. So that's in the fall. So it's not much growth. Let's see the year before. Did I have ryegrass in this? I might not have reported it because it was really bad the year before. So, you know, I think it's the same cost, though, to fly it on, isn't it? 20 pounds to the acre flown on or 25. The plane would have to go when it's not as windy, though, right? Because it's such a light seed like oats. So then your window is just shorter, where rye, you know, has more of a, cereal rye has more of a window because it's heavier. Yeah. So they're probably the same cost per acre to use. Other questions?
One point of confusion about ryegrass is that there are several different kinds, right? So there's annual ryegrass, there's perennial ryegrass, which theoretically lives 2, 3, 4 years, and then there's Italian ryegrass, which is actually volume.
Yes. Yes, so the ryegrass industry is trying to deal with this actually because they do have seed lots that are not 100% pure annual ryegrass. And I've heard them at their meetings say, we've really got to clean this up because we've got things going into our mixes that shouldn't, or things going into our bags that shouldn't be. But that's probably the same actually for most of the cover crop industry as people are getting started. There's a lot of seed out there that you really shouldn't be planting. So you want to go to companies that have tags on the bag because that's reputable and it's been tested, or you want to germ test it yourself for sure. But with annual ryegrass, Italian ryegrass and perennial ryegrass all mixed together, you're not going to know until the next year. You're not really going to know. So I don't know, I'm just a little cautious on ryegrass. Right.
Just
doesn't grow very much?
Just
don't get it. Yeah. Yeah, because you need the top growth to get the bottom growth. I mean, it's, you know, after rye gets started or ryegrass gets started, it does start putting roots down. But if there's not enough leaves for photosynthesis, you know, it can't put any more roots down than the leaves out there. So it really, you know, cereal rye is growing under the snow and putting roots down, where ryegrass is dormant by that time if it didn't winter kill already. So we're pretty cold for ryegrass, I think.
Sure.
But prove me wrong. Try it. Yeah. Yeah, so Tom Casper has the longest, I'd say, soil quality data off of corn bean with cereal rye. And it at about the 8 to 9 year mark, he's able to increase his soil organic matter 0.1% at the 9 year mark when he's growing the amount of rye that's in that picture I showed you. So he's really growing a lot of rye, where most farmers aren't growing that amount of rye. So it takes a long time. Where is that picture? I already passed it. It takes a lot longer in a 2 year rotation to see the soil improvement benefits than if we stuck a third crop in there. Absolutely. If we stuck a third crop in there, you're gonna see soil improvements in like 3 to 4 years. One cycle of the rotation, you'll see improvements in soil quality. You'll see reductions in bulk density. You'll see increases in organic matter. You'll see increases in soil micropopulations. Yeah. Yeah, so Dr. Matt Liebman at Iowa State, he's had plots in place 9 to 10 years, I want to say. It's a 2 year corn soybean rotation, a 3 year corn soybeans oats is his small grain, plus red clover. He does all fall tillage, so he turns the red clover under in the fall, and then in the spring either puts on cattle manure or uses the late spring soil nitrate test to add synthetic fertilizer. Then the 4 year is corn, soybeans, oats with alfalfa, and then a second year of alfalfa, which normally you'd go longer, but for his study, it's just establishment plus one. And the 3 year rotation is competitive with the 2 year, even over these last 9 years of high corn and bean prices. Why would you think that it would be competitive? The 3 year rotation. Growing oats in the rotation was competitive than just growing corn and soybeans every year. Why might that be?
Input costs.
You drop nitrogen need 86 to 90% in the 3 year because you grow nitrogen with red clover, and you reduce herbicide needs by about 86% in his system because you're using multiple tools for weed control, not just depending on an herbicide. So you're saving money behind the farm gate, basically. You're controlling those costs, and that's the reason why.
And you're going to get rid of
rootworm. You're going to get rid of rootworm. You're going to get rid of a whole host of problems, yes. And he's not making any money on the oats, right? That year is just for growing profit for the corn year, basically. I mean, oats, it's like break even every year for him. We're not very far from several oat markets right here. You know, and grain millers and General Mills got to go to northern Saskatchewan practically to get oats now. They don't want to do that anymore. They would rather grow oats here. I mean, they would rather buy oats here more. So if you could even break even with oats and grow a good red clover stand, you can really drop off on the inputs.
Where can we get access to that kind of information?
Yeah, so there's some published research in PLOS One, PLOS One, and you just like Google Liebman Marsden Farm. The Leopold Center has some handouts on it. We have 7 farmers doing that on the ground right now, so we'll have publications out about that probably by February of their economics. You know, and if red clover doesn't grow by harvest of oats or wheat or whatever, you can put in a diverse cover crop mix. You can just switch that out. You know, you're going to have that seed cost already out there. But if weather was bad for red clover and you can't do it, you can still grow a lot of nitrogen with a 12-way cover crop mix that's $20 to $25 an acre. So, you know, there's flexibility in the system. Then you're spreading your labor out. And if you have manure, you have a place to put it in August. I mean, what are we going to do right now? There's manure going on right now. It's frozen. So if we had time in August and September with land open, you'd have a hot commodity for manure application. So, you know, we don't think about small grains as being profitable, and they themselves aren't, but they allow the rest of the system to be more profitable, to be competitive.
Spread your workflow.
And spread your workflow, yeah. So if you'd like to be in any trials, we're always looking.
We do have a little extra time. Yeah. It's going to be about 15 minutes late. So, Sarah, if you have to keep going, that's fine. Otherwise, if you're willing to take more questions, if people want to continue to ask these questions, that's fine too.
Yeah, if there's other questions.
If you have a cow calf operation and you've got an open slate to produce the best forage and cuttings and quality as possible.
Yeah.
What would you recommend?
Yeah, so I would still do corn. Let me just bring this slide up here that I didn't put in. But then if you can work a small grain in so you can plant those summer annuals. Summer annuals are really the key, I think, to reducing feed costs because the slump on your pasture hits in August. So if you can have a summer annual growing out there, like sorghum Sudan grass, Japanese millet, cowpea, fava bean, I mean, get a really diverse mix out there. You're gonna have the tonnage and the quality, and you need to hay or graze that by frost. You could put kale in it. Kale's a natural dewormer, so then you could back off some of the deworming stuff. Or you could separate and just do the summer grasses and legumes, and then have another succession of winter grasses for later grazing, you know, grazing through the winter. So this is just some amounts, you know, where folks weren't really trying to grow a lot of cover crop for grazing. By mid-March, there was just only about 200 pounds of dry matter out there, winter rye. And this is only at a bushel planting rate. They're not thinking of using this for cattle. But by mid-May, you know, it's a ton or so, a ton and a half worth of material. So if you could just delay planting a week or so, you'd have all that forage, and by mid-May, it's at its peak on relative feed value. It's like, you know, 150 to 170 relative feed value. So for a 1,400-pound cattle consuming 3% of her body weight, at 50% grazing efficiency, by April, you'd have 5 grazing days, but by May 5th, you'd have 25 grazing days. You know, so that really adds up when hay is expensive. And then, you know, for the height, just to calibrate your eye, this I think is most important. So if the plant's 2 inches tall, that's about 260 pounds of dry matter. But if the plant's 8 inches tall, that's about a half a ton of dry matter. And then you can just see, you know, it grows exponentially, which is also why it becomes a weed before corn. And you got to be careful to kill it if you're not going to use it for cattle. But if you're going to use it for cattle, yeah, it's a big reduction in feed costs. We have folks that have collected that data, and that'll be in a research report coming out here before December 5th on our website. So you can see like the dollars and cents. And these farmers are putting cover crop onto row crop ground that's their neighbors, and then they're getting access to that, and they've created a relationship because they want to feed less stored feeds. And the neighbor row crop farmer wants the cattle gleaning corn stalks, grazing cover crop, and pooping on his ground. So it's a good relationship. So if you can find that, which that's not always easy, but if you can find that, that's a really big win-win for both of them. So if you didn't do just winter and you did summer, then, you know, gosh, the sky's the limit on the summer mix. I would just make sure you keep costs in line and always put sorghum Sudan grass in it because that's just such a high amount of quantity. Or BMR, any of the sorghums. Or like a grazing corn maybe even. Don't you guys have like a summer mix maybe? Yeah.
This whole area is still being developed. Yeah, we can move a whole bunch of different things.
What about like Sudan Paja, things like that?
I haven't tested them. I don't know. Some people want to try TEF. I don't know much about them. Yeah. Yeah, so your biggest concern planting summer annuals is just moisture. So you have to have good soil to seed contact and you have to have some rain in July, which is tough. So those warm season grasses are tolerant of low moisture conditions, so they should be able to get going. But if it's like nothing, like 2012, you might have to wait until there's another rain and go with like a winter grass instead. That makes farming fun.